Three.
Why not?
Two. What's up, everyone? Welcome to our first video cast, podcast, whatever we're going to call this thing. The first episode. Juan, I'm so excited. This is going to
be. Yeah, me too.
So hopefully you watched the video that we sent out yesterday. These are called LIFTs, okay? And that just stands for Lifestyle and Identity Focused Training. So each week, every single Friday, just to reiterate, every Friday we're going to be putting out a new podcast or a new episode, a new session. I don't know. We'll figure out what they're called eventually. But we're going to be going through the four core values of our worship team. And that's just the heartbeat of what we're going to do, why we're doing it. And so I'm really excited. Today we're going to be talking about lifting his name above everything else. And so one thing I want to encourage you guys to do, if you have a notebook or you have your phone or something, I would encourage you just to take a few notes. We're going to be sending some scripture your way, some points to remember and to grab hold of. So I know when I was growing up, and Juan was saying earlier, you know, every time you write something down, you just remember it so much better. So without further ado, let's get started. So Juan, why don't you go ahead and tell us what we're talking about today?
Yes. So just as Kaylin just said, we're going to be covering, you know, different core values for us that we think are important to us as a worship team. But specifically, this first core value is, I think, not just essential for us as a worship team, but also for us as worshipers in general, people that were created to worship God. And you probably guessed it. It's Jesus, the person that we're all focusing in on. And when it comes to Jesus-centered worship, sometimes it can be so broad. And so we want to kind of dive in a little bit deeper. And so we're going to be jumping in, because if we're going to get to know anything about worship, we need to go to God's word. We need to understand. We need to unpack this in depth. And I believe that in Revelation chapter 5, verses 6 and 9 is where we can find that. Now, probably a lot of y'all, when you think about the book of Revelation, you probably think, you know, end times, like eeriness.
It's so intense.
Yeah, I know. And I, to be honest, like, there's even some parts of Revelation that I'm still even unpacking as I'm reading it. Definitely. But it's all about this man, John the disciple, who had this amazing vision of heaven that was so elaborate. And he would go into detail about every little thing that he experienced, not just, you know, things that were to come in the future and the sign of the end times, but also you see in Revelation chapter 4 and 5 is this basically this ginormous worship service, you know, something kind of like a Sunday morning or a Wednesday night, but on a whole nother level, you know. And so John goes in depth as to, he's describing every little thing as he's seeing it, and he's just in amazement of what's happening. And so let's just start reading right here in Revelation 5, starting with verse 6, where it says, "Then I saw a young lamb," which is Jesus, "standing in the middle of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the 24 elders," which is God's creation. "He appeared to have been slaughtered, but was now alive. And they were all singing this new song of praise to the Lamb." And it says here, "Because you were slaughtered for us, you are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals. Your blood was the price paid to redeem us. You purchased us to bring us to God out of every tribe, every language, people group, and nation." And so this scripture is jam-packed, y'all, with so much content, and specifically when it comes to all these different things that are happening in heaven as they're worshiping Jesus, as all of creation is surrounding themselves around the throne room of God, where Jesus is put right in the middle, and they're just pouring out as they see Jesus there in the flesh. They just can't help but pour out worship before him, and that he is the primary focus. And so, you know, with that, as we learn, you know, to, if you want to write in your notes, what we're going to be talking about today is about going back to the basics, going back to the basics of what worship is. And I believe there was a man in history that probably understood the concept of what it meant to go back to the basics better than probably any other influential person that I have seen in history. And his name was John Wooden. Coach John Wooden was the coach of the UCLA Bruins back, like, he coached from 1948 until about the 1970s, around there. And so a little ways away some time ago. And this coach, I mean, this dude was successful. Kaylin, I didn't tell you this, but he won 10 national championships with one team in 12 years. He went on to win also 21 regional division championships. He was even considered, and even till today, Time Magazine voted him as the greatest ever sports coach of all time.
Wow.
Which is, you know, quite a title to have to your name, man. Like, to have a legacy where you're known as the greatest coach of all time. The GOAT of GOATs. And so this man, what was so fascinating was not just his success and, you know, the players that would come through his basketball program, but it was also the way he went about it. Because, I mean, this dude, he was a perfectionist when it came to fundamentals. Now, if you know anything about sports, if you're an athlete even, when it comes to fundamentals, they're not necessarily fun, like the word fundamental says. But fundamentals basically is, you know, the things that you do to train your body to get ready before you ever run a drill or do anything with your team. Ways that you train your body to get to stay healthy, to stay ready, even the smallest details. That, in fact, Coach Wooden, he would do this with his players, that for the first ever practice of the season, that he would take all of his players that came from all over the nation, you know, super athletic, super professional. They're looking to go to the best basketball program in the nation.
Sure.
And rather than running a drill, rather than, you know, getting the team together and trying to devise the game plan or whatever, the first thing he would do is teach them how to put their socks on the right way. Now, just imagine for a second, again, grown men coming together and they're like learning like, okay, let's put on our right sock the right way and then our left sock.
Like,
yo, I would be livid, you know?
Like, sir, I've been putting socks on all my life.
Yo, like, for real though. And so, but the reason why Coach Wooden would do this and that he would frustrate his players and what he would say is that if they didn't learn how to put their socks on the right way, they would then start getting blisters on their feet, and then blisters would affect their performance out on the court. And I mean, it wasn't just the socks. I mean, he would tell them how to cut their hair a certain way. They couldn't have long hair. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was strategic and perfectionist when it came to the fundamentals, to the very basic things. And people would be like, yo, coach, like, why are you making us go through this? This is like basic things that we already kind of know, but he wanted to make sure and drill into his players this very fundamental thing before they could ever become great in basketball. He didn't care if you were the flashiest player, if you knew how to dribble a ball a certain way and all these other things, if you could do no-look passes, he cared about the fundamentals. And in the same way, for me and you as worship leaders, and not only that, but as worshipers, we need to understand this one bottom line, and that is Jesus is the foundation and the focus of our worship.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna say it again so you can write it down, remember it, that Jesus is the foundation and the focus of our worship. And so, Kaylin, how about you kind of unpack that for us? Like, what does that look like to have Jesus as the center of our worship?
Yeah, I love that one. That story's so good too. I think there's two main ways that we can apply the scripture and the story to our own lives. And the first one is a daily heart check. And that's not even so much about like sitting down and thinking, oh, what's going on in my heart, but it's taking time, it's reading his word, it's praying to God and saying, Lord, would you search my heart, would you reveal to me the things that maybe are not making you the focus, the things that are not making you the foundation of everything. And it's taking the perspective off of ourselves, like in our own selfish way, and surrendering who we are and saying, Lord, I'm giving all this to you. Now you show me the things that I need to lay down. You show me who I need to be to better glorify who you are and who you've called me to be. And I first thing I thought of was Psalm 139, and it talks over and over again. It says, search me, oh Lord, search my heart. You know me. There's a part that says, you knew me before I was even born. He knows our thoughts. He knows the hairs on our head. He knows every detail about us. It better than we could even know ourselves. And so if we just say, Lord, would you reveal to me the ways that maybe I haven't been worshiping you as the top priority or as my main focus, Lord, for any of the moments that it's been about me, God, I surrender those things now. And I believe that when we take that time and we surrender those moments and those things, he's going to show us and he's going to fill those places with more of who he wants us to be and how he wants us to give our lives to him in worship and in everything that we do. And I think there's a second way as well. And Juan, why don't you touch on that second way?
Yeah, this is especially important for me and Kaylin, you know, because we don't want to challenge you in something that we're not already trying to do in our own lives. Mm-hmm. And especially when it comes to practicing personal worship, because we're very used to worship in congregational settings in a big crowd whenever we get together on Sundays and on Wednesdays. But especially now when we're in our homes, mainly, you know, due to the health crisis and what's happening, this is a great opportunity for us to develop this practice, this discipline of personal worship. And what I mean by that is basically, you know, take a time where you just focus on Jesus, take yourself out of the picture, like you were just saying, Kaylin, and just give God praise, give God thanks. Just, there's always a reason to praise God for his worthiness, for his love, for his truth, and for his grace. And so just take some time, strip everything away. So, and you know, if it's like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, it's up to you how long that time is, but we encourage you to find time where you, like for myself, like recently, and I've been doing this every week, is like, I'll grab my acoustic guitar and I don't have like an agenda. I don't have like a planning center with songs that I'm going to sing. Yeah. All I'm doing is like, I'll put on like a pad and just like get my acoustic or something like that. And I'll just begin singing songs that come into my heart, that the Lord lays on my heart. And sometimes, to be honest though, even in times like that, I can still make it about myself. I can make it about the music and trying to sound good. I can make it all about the lyrics. I'm just focusing on the lyrics. Or, you know, and then when we get more to like corporate worship, when we're just focusing on the people, because you can imagine, like, when we get before our peers, sometimes it can be a little nerve-wracking and we're just thinking about how they think of us when we're leading worship or whenever we're playing. But rather than looking vertically, looking to the God that this is all about in essence, and all about Jesus. And so, well, we encourage you to do this, you know, in your own bedroom, in your prayer room, or whatever that looks like, and to develop that discipline, and to just come before the Lord, thank him, take yourself out of the picture for a moment. Don't worry about praying for other people, which is almost kind of selfish in a way, but don't worry about also for yourself. Just focus on him and just tell him how good he is. Because like in that scripture that we just read, you can see in the song that all of creation was singing to heaven, four times it says the word you in reference to Jesus. Guess how many times it said me? Zip.
Yeah.
That this song, that all of creation, and they're literally singing this 24/7 for all of eternity. Think about that for a second, like nonstop. They're just looking at Jesus and telling him how good he is.
Yeah.
So I just encourage for all of us to do that. So what are you thinking?
One thing you said was, you know, it's turning our focus to him, and he is worthy no matter what we see, no matter what we feel, he is worthy of our praise. And I love what it says in the scripture. It says they're singing a new song of praise to the Lamb. Because you were slaughtered for us, you are worthy. And sometimes we get so focused, especially now with this health crisis, we get so focused on the bad and the things that we're facing that aren't fair or are difficult. But when we refocus our minds and our hearts on this, it says, because you were slaughtered for us, you gave your life for us, simply because you sacrificed everything. Yeah. And I love that this is coming out this week too, because this is the week that we are celebrating his life. Because of that, he is worthy. No matter what we see, no matter what we feel, he is always worthy of our praise. And so I love that. I hope you guys have enjoyed this talk, this just, I don't know. I'm just so excited for these. It's been so good. And so let us know, like message us, let us know what you're thinking, what you're feeling with these. We can't wait to send more your way. Again, there's going to be another one coming out next Friday. And we just love you guys so much. And so thankful to have you a part of our team, a part of our family. And we love you. We miss you.
Yeah.
All right. Bye, y'all.
All right, we're signing out. Peace.